Okay, so welcome everyone. Thanks very much for attending my talk. Just in the beginning, the last time in this conference, you need to like see this information about the fire exit announcement, and you can read it where when I will like introduce myself. So my name is Andrei Krasnitski. I live and work in Minsk, Belarus. I work as a software engineer in Altoros, but maybe someone preferred to call it Cloud Foundry Engineer because most of our work performed using the Cloud Foundry deployments. And today I will talk about the UAA Authentication for Kubernetes cluster. I will explain how to use it. We'll show the quick demo, how it will be could be implemented. And yeah, so like the brief agenda. So we will be talking about the authentication authorization options, which is already built in Kubernetes. I will go more deeply in the option which allow us to use the UAA component to authentication of the Kubernetes users. And I will show the demo with the like real life example of the running PCF environment and the PKS, which is use UAA certification. And then I will, like, as usual, explore some I will show some important links and resources which can be used, which you will try to like implement the same authentication for your Kubernetes cluster. So let's start with the brief overview of what is Kubernetes. So Kubernetes is open source container orchestration platform. It can be deployed to any IaaS, so it's multi-cloud solution. It's container-based solution. Basically, you will deploy the Docker or RKT containers on the Kubernetes, and also it has rich API support, so almost every operation against the Kubernetes cluster could be performed using the API. And now let's jump to authentication and authorization options, or AuthN and AuthZ, as they usually called when we use in the Kubernetes. So authentication is the process which determines who we are when you provide some your identity, and authorization perform when system is already know who you are, but it's try to retrieve some additional parameters about your user and like say that you allowed or not allowed to perform some action based on this information. The good example for the AuthN and AuthZ in the real life could be visa and a passport on the border control. For example, officer will check your passport to see that you are the person who like pretending to be, and AuthZ in this case will be the visa, which shows that you allowed or not to go to like destination country. Who is the actual consumers of the AuthN and AuthZ in the Kubernetes cluster? So first of all, this is end users, which is usually use the kubectl command to communicate with the cluster. And the second option is the machine-to-machine communication. So it's all internal workflow use also the AuthN, AuthZ to perform. So it could be Kubernetes pods. It could be so-called control plane, which if nobody knows what, maybe someone doesn't know what is control plane, is the component of the Kubernetes which drives the all internal workflow of the Kubernetes cluster. It includes the API server, control, and scheduler, and some other components. Let's try to understand how the AuthN and AuthZ performed in the Kubernetes. So first of all, when operator or like some end user try to perform some action against the Kubernetes cluster, your request comes to some authentication plugin. And I should mention that plugin is something not similar. If maybe good example will be Jenkins, you can't deploy the plugin for the AuthN or AuthZ on the fly. It's pre-built in the Kubernetes API server binary, so you need to like create your own binary, update the cluster, and then you can use your own plugin. By default, we have several plugins built in the Kubernetes, but I will talk about it later. So first of all, our request comes to the authentication cluster based on the user ID and the password, which retrieves by the Kubernetes API. It shows that we are allowed or not to work with the Kubernetes cluster. Then this request comes to the authorization plugin. And at the authorization plugin, we can see that we allowed and denied to do some work against the Kubernetes cluster. And then it comes to the admission control component. It's like some additional component which can mutate or perform some modification in the API request which is coming to your Kubernetes server, and then it will go like to directly to the some component of the Kubernetes which you're trying to retrieve. For example, it could be paths or some API information about your users or something else. So let's continue with the authentication strategies, which is already presented in the current build of the Kubernetes. I will like describe any which is available right now, but we'll like show some information about most preferred in our UA use case. So the first one is the X500 client certificates. Most of our installation before were used this type of authentication, but it was like bad solution because we used the only one shared certificate for all clusters. And we know like this is a terrible solution, and that's why we like started the research in how to use the UAA authentication. So basically here we have some certificate authority and we have some client certificate which is signed by this certificate authority. And when we create some request to our API server, we see that, hey, this certificate is signed by this authority, so we can work with this cluster. We actually trust this cert. And the username in this case will be the common name which you can retrieve from the client certificate. It will be more important. We will go to the AUC option in the Kubernetes. So next option is the static password or static token. In the case of Kubernetes, this is just CSV files, which is placed somewhere on the file system. They have this secret username combination. And if in this case, your username is admin and you use this super secret password as a secret password, then you're allowed to use with the Kubernetes. And it's pretty much the same for the tokens. We have like combination of the user and token, and better after that we can use this token using the kubectl command to like perform some action against the Kubernetes cluster. Obviously, it's like not the best solution, but this can be good if you want to like spin up the quick server, perform some action, verify something, and just for testing, I would say. So next option is the service accounts. Service accounts is usually used for some non-interactive workflow with the Kubernetes. The good example, and if you will open the documentation for the Kubernetes, it will be Jenkins server. For example, you can create the service account using this kubectl create service account command, and it will create some secret, which will include the API token and the certificate for your workflow. Then you can add this token to your some long running process and just work with the Kubernetes using this token. So all you need just to provide this token to the authorization header inside of your API request, and that's it. The next option, it's like pretty new option, but someone may use it. It's called the webhook tokens. And this option is usually used when you want to use some external service to perform authentication actions against the Kubernetes cluster. So how it works, first of all, end user put some request to the Kubernetes cluster with the token, and Kubernetes cluster will perform the review action against some existing external service. And based on the information of the service, it will receive the review status and like allow you or not to work with the Kubernetes API. And the most important option in terms of this presentation, it's so-called OpenID Connect. I will give the quick review on this. So if you ever heard about the OpenID, you should know that this is nothing to do with the OpenID. OpenID Connect is just extension on top of OAuth 2, and but instead of like usual workflow of OAuth 2, it's retrieved some additional tokens, which you can use for further identification. This token is JSON web token. It contains information like user mail, which is very convenient when you want to perform this authentication against the cluster. So this is like, may look like a mess, but this is how JSON web token looks like. It consists from three parts. The first part is the metadata. It shows like how our JSON token encrypted. The second part is contains the metadata for our web token, and it's usually called the payload, and it contains the all information about our user, about the identity provider, and so on. And the last part is a signature, which is used to verify the token against some existing identity provider. So this is, if you will try to encode the second part of the JSON web token, it may look something like this. So here we have information about our user, and it can be used, like we have the email field, we have the username field, we have our IDP provider, so it's all information which is required by the any OpenID Connect integration. So by default, and not by default, Kubernetes doesn't provide any identity provider from the out of the box. You can use some existing, for example, Google, Microsoft, Yahoo, PayPal, Amazon, they all provide some identity providers. You can use these providers. And also you can use a couple of self-hosted if you will try to deploy it on your own. And like DEX is most common case. And UAA also can be used as identity provider for Kubernetes. If you will, you may Google for existing OpenID connected identity providers, you may find some more, but you need to know that identity providers need to have two requirements to work with the Kubernetes. The first one is that identity providers should publish all the metadata information on some well-known URL, which is used for discovery. And the second requirement that OpenID provider should run always in TLS mode. I will just briefly describe what is UAA, because like it's just OpenID identity provider, which we can use for our cluster. So UAA is the service which is usually used within the Cloud Foundry deployments, where a user authentication is managed. It supports it's basically OAuth 2 server. It can be connected to some external SAML, OLDAP, or you can use it as OpenID provider. It has rich API support. You can perform any action using the UAA API. And yeah, that's like, let's go to the workflow of the authentication in the case of the OpenID and the Kubernetes. So first of all, our user will send the login request to our identity provider, and if this request is successful, as a response, you will receive the access token and ID token, which we will use to authenticate against the Kubernetes. So you need to provide this information to the kubeconfig. You can configure the config in your home folder if you prefer, or you can use --ID token option in the kubectl. Then, regarding on this information, this JSON web token will be sent to the API server, and API server will perform some additional checks on this JSON web token. It includes the validate the JSON web token signature. It will check that maybe this token is already expired, and it will check that is actually this user authorized to do some work against the Kubernetes API. Then, if everything is okay, it will receive the response to the Kubernetes kubectl command line tool, and this tool will return the kubectl this response to the end user. So now let's continue with the OAuth option in the Kubernetes. Once again, it works in the following way. So when you already authenticated in the system, Kubernetes API will perform some additional checks that you allow to access the resource which you're trying to retrieve, for example. I will go to the like most popular resources for the AUZ in the Kubernetes, which is, you may know, they already built in the Kube release of some of you using this release. So the first one is the ABAC. ABAC is stored in the same way as the password or static tokens. This is just plain file, CSV file. Sorry, not CSV, just file on your file system. And its format is one JSON by line. So you can specify some existing groups or user and specify that this user is allowed to perform some action against some namespace, can access some resources, and so on. And when it grows, you can have something like that. For example, in this case, we have the group developers, which can access any resources in the dev space, dev namespace, but we also want to like be able to developers to access the production namespace, but in this case, they will have only read-only mode, so we can be sure that developers can watch logs, for example, but they can perform any action like delete or something like some harmful for our cluster. And the second option is the airbag. So central concept of the airbag is roles, and this is essentially just a collection of the rules. For example, you can have developer rule, which has one set of permission for your cluster, and you can have some administrator role, which have like full access to your system. Roles are it's always allowed to work with some existing namespace. You specify it in this file. And if you use cluster role, they apply it to cluster-wide. And second concept is role cluster binding or role binding. It works in pretty much the same way as the roles. You grant permission to some previously created role. And for example, in this case, we have a user, Andrei Krasnitski, Altoros.com, which can access any resources which is described in pod and pod logs reader binding. So you have some role, you bind some group or user to this role and like allow to work with some resources on your Kubernetes cluster. And here's some like small comparison between the airbag and ABAC. So once again, that to manage ABAC, you need to manage the file on your local system. It's maybe not the best solution. Maybe in the case if you're working with the Bosch, you can like specify some properties in your deployment manifest, but if you use like plain Kubernetes deployed by some, maybe you deploy it by the hands, it may be like hard to configure this file. And the second, like not preferred way to use ABAC, that ABAC required to restart API server every time when you trying to update the policy files. So, and in the same time, airbag can be managed by Kubernetes API. You can apply changes on the fly. So it's like default approved action, approved rule to work with the Kubernetes. And most of, for example, Kube release, CFCR, PKS, they all can be configured with airbag option. So now I will show the quick demo how OpenID works with the Kubernetes. Let me share my screen. Sorry, second. Display. Okay. Can you see?
Yes.
Okay. So I have my PKS installation running on G Cloud, but it's a bit modified. installation. I will talk about it later. But and I have my PCF running in AWS, so I will create the new user on the my PCF installation. Let's call it Summit 18 NA, for example, and the password will be the password. Okay, I will not assign any roles because it will just use the username and password combination in the Kubernetes. And now we need to retrieve the ID token from our UAA. I will use small library. Any OpenID Connect providers have this library on some GitHub page. It's used to retrieve this ID token and put this ID token to our kubeconfig file. So I'll provide just the name and password to this helper. I will share the tool later. Yeah, it shows the ID token for our client. We also have here the refresh token. And after that, we configured the our username in a kubeconfig. So now I need to set context for this user. So I will use the config. Context name is summit18na. I have only one default cluster, and I will the user the same. Yeah, now I can try to perform some action against the Kubernetes cluster, and it will show the, oh, I need to use this context, sorry. Config use context summit18na. Yeah, now, yeah, it retrieves the error that we're not allowed to work with the Kubernetes API because our Z plugin shows that, hey, user summit18na doesn't have any rules configured in the our RBAC. So now I will switch back to the default user, which is admin user. I have this UA. I have the user role bind file, which is used to configure the user role and user role binding. So I have the already running cluster admin role. It's like default role in the Kubernetes cluster, and I will just bind our new created user to this cluster role. So it will be the summit NA. To create this role binding, use the same command that you used to like run Nginx, for example, on your cluster. Just create the chef and pass to your manifest. I will just change some names. Yeah, and we can switch back to our new user. And yeah, we now can work with our Kubernetes. So the configuration is really easy. You just use existing user from the Cloud Foundry, create the roles and role binding for this user, and like that's it. So let me open back my presentation. So how to configure OpenID Connect if you use some implementation not deployed by Bosch. So you just need to provide the OpenID URL for your identity cluster. Usually it's UAA.system domain. If you're using some existing PCF installation, you need to provide some client ID to verify the signature of your JSON web token. You need to specify that we use email as the username. It's default requirement when you're using the UA. And if you use some self-signed certificate, you need to also provide the certificate to cluster installation. And if you're using, for example, Kubernetes, these two commits includes all this configuration in the manifest, so you just need to provide a couple of properties like any other board release, and then you can use this with the Kube release. But one more thing, that currently UAA is not fully compatible with the OpenID Connect plugin implementation in the Kubernetes. It's already patched in the development branch, but we still need to wait for like next minor release. It will be included in this release. So yeah, like benefits is of the solution that we can use the single entry point for both installation for Cloud Foundry and the Kubernetes. OpenID Connect includes discovery, so we can use this discovery to verify our JSON web token against the our identity provider. We can retrieve the some expiration data from these endpoints. And it's really easy to configure. You just need to provide a couple of additional flags to your Kubernetes cluster. And it's also minimize the security risk because many users try to use the same password for like one login. And in this case, it will be like single sign-on for both of your clusters. So, and if anyone want try to deploy it on your own, you can use the Kubernetes. You can use this helpful tool, which is used to retrieve the ID token and access token from my OpenID provider. And also, you, if you need some help, you always can like open the Slack. You can go to CFCR channel in the Cloud Foundry Slack. You can go to SIGEOS on Kubernetes Slack, and you will always find some information about how to implement some kind of authentication on your cluster. So this is it. Maybe you have any questions. Sure. You mean to use some AUS plugin for Kubernetes?
Yeah.
They already pre-built in the Kubernetes API binary, so they already in the Kubernetes. But in this case, as I said, for UAA, you need to like build it manually because not all patches included in current stable release. So my installation was installed using like pre-compiled binary, so like I pre-compiled the master branch. It's just a master branch. It's like another version. Okay. So that's it. Thank you.